Good morning, and thank you for joining us for the celebration of our Holy Eucharist. We warmly welcome everyone. We are glad to be able to celebrate together, and we are happy to have you share your faith with us. Please take a moment to meet the people sitting around you and ask how you can pray for them during our liturgy. Let us now take a few moments in silence as we quiet our hearts to celebrate the sacred mysteries of our faith.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. I'd like to invite any children who would like to go to the children's liturgy, the Sunday school, to please come to the front. As we get closer to Easter, may our excitement grow to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I know this.
Yeah, you're good. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. By your help, we beseech you, Lord our God, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Oh God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Whoever serves me must follow me, says the Lord. Where I am, there will my servant be also. Glory to you, Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. The person who loves their life loses it, and the person who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. The readings today all speak of contrition and sorrow for our sins, repentance and conversion, and healing of our heart, which is what I want to talk about today, some thoughts or meditations on repentance, conversion, and healing, especially as we get ready for this week, which is a day of confessions on Wednesday, and an encouragement to all of us to take advantage of this sacrament before Easter. In the psalm that we sang today, it said, "Create in me a clean heart." This is from King David. He wrote this psalm, Psalm 51. "Create in me a clean heart." And King David, as you know, sinned very seriously. He had committed adultery and As a consequence of that, he had committed a murder. And so he was in a very bad place. But he was still confident enough to come to the Lord, asking just not just for forgiveness, but for a deep healing. Wash away my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin, create in me a clean heart. You know, our heart is the place where these different movements of our soul occur, and they can be for the good or for the bad. Jesus says, out of the heart can proceed evil things. And so I think when David is saying, create in me a clean heart, he's saying an open heart, a pure heart, a spacious heart, a generous heart, a compassionate heart, from which can flow the Holy Spirit things, love, peace, joy, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. And so we need to be like King David. We need to be able to come before the Lord, judging ourselves guilty of our sins, yes, knowing that the Lord is the great judge, but also with great hope that the Lord is our friend. St. Jose Maria said that we come before the Lord maybe a little afraid because he's going to be a judge, but let's not forget that he is our friend as well. Jesus says, I will lift up all things to myself. It says in the first reading today, I will forgive their evil doing and remember their sin no more. So one of the lessons I like about King David was that he wasn't afraid to talk to the Lord honestly about what was going in his heart. He wasn't afraid to come before God. I know in my own experience, and I think hearing a lot of confessions, that people, when they sin, are sometimes afraid or ashamed to come before God. It's hard to return to prayer. We sort of want to hide, which makes sense. That goes back to Adam and Eve. They committed the original sin, and their instinct was to hide from God. God walked in the garden and said, "Where are you?" We hid from you because we were afraid. One of the consequences of sin is this separation or this alienation, this fear to come before God. But David had, in spite of his sin, had a deep and trusting relationship with God the Father. We know his sin was serious. It affected a lot of people. It affected his wives. It affected Bathsheba. It affected Uriah, whom he betrayed, deceived, and had killed. It affected his children. They looked at their father who had mistreated their mother and their family with such carelessness and disrespect. It affected the people that he led and served, who looked up to him as a hero, as a great king. It dishonored his kingdom. And of course, it affected his relationship with God. But he didn't allow his heart to be hardened. You know, so many times in the Old Testament, we hear about how people's hearts were hardened, like King Pharaoh. And God warns us against that. He says, do not harden your hearts, like at Meribah, like at Massa, in the wilderness. David knew that his heart could be healed, and so he approached God with hope. And the Lord knew something about David, that he had this potential to be restored, to be renewed. When he was chosen to be king, he wasn't the first to be picked. First, Samuel had decided that he was going to pick one of his brothers. He wasn't the tallest, he wasn't the strongest, he wasn't the oldest. But Samuel told the people, the Lord sees not as man sees, not on the outward appearance, but on the heart. I think one of the things that I took away from this is that this is about what happens inside. So much of our life, we are concerned of what happens outside, our appearance, our how people perceive us, our reputation. It's kind of external things that really matter to us. But as I've mentioned a number of times, I want and I've prayed that this Lent is a time of interior healing, deep healing for all of us, an interior or an inside transformation, that from the inside out, our hearts become pure, they're purified. They're made whole, they're made new, they're made fresh. And so maybe you sit there and you think, I feel my heart is a little hardened, or maybe I have a guilt of sin that I carry with me and it makes me hesitant to come before God, or makes prayer to feel a bit awkward or a little uncomfortable. I hope the lesson that we draw from this, or the resolution that we can craft, is that, like King David, I can come before the Lord with honesty and humility and humbleness, recognizing that God wants to be in relationship with me, has the power, the ability, to heal our hearts. One way that we can do that is by recognizing, even one step deeper, what is it that causes us to want to sin? You know, at a level even deeper than the sin in our hearts, what is the movement inside of us that makes us drawn to sin? There are these beautiful litanies called the litanies of the heart, and they try to help us articulate or to say or to speak to God about what's going on deep inside of us at a core level, at an emotional level. And so in these beautiful litanies where we pray for our wounded hearts, for our fearful hearts, for our closed hearts, we say to the Lord, very honestly, very humbly, like King David, Lord, I offer you my heart with all its sufferings. I offer you my heart with all its doubts, with all its hurts, with all its fears, with all its burdens, with all its hope and all its lack of hope, with all its joy and with all its lack of joy. I offer you my heart with all its love and all its lack of love. We can say to the Lord exactly what's going on inside of us. The Lord wants to hear us. And then we speak about these things that move deep in us when I'm withdrawn, when I'm consumed with worry, when I feel numbed out, when I feel cynical, when I lose trust, when I'm distracted, when I try to escape my feelings, when I'm holding stress, when I'm under pressure, when I'm filled with anger, when I'm obsessed with my tasks, when I feel ashamed, when I feel unforgiven. We tell the Lord, these are the things that move deep inside of me, and these are the things that lead me to seek these unhealthy outlets. When I don't feel safe, when I feel chaotic, when I feel confused, when I can't trust, when I feel hurt, when I feel unloved, when I feel disappointed, when I feel rejected, when I feel let down, when I feel hopeless. Lord, when I feel unseen, when I feel unheard, when I feel inferior, humiliated, lonely, unlovable, or filled with despair. Lord, I tell you about all these things because I have hope that you can do something deep within me. And so I ask you, Lord, help me, guide me, teach me, protect me, console me, soothe my weary heart, see my pain, calm my fears, hear my cries, draw close to me, shine your light, be present with me, walk with me, accept me, delight in me, forgive me, give me new life, contain my stress, relieve the pressure, give meaning to my life. This week, as we come into our prayer, let us speak honestly from the depths of our hearts to the Lord with a great trust, great faith that Jesus is a consoler, that he's tender, that he's our hope, that he created us, that he sees us, that he knows us, that he comforts us, that he values us, that he encourages us. Don't let fear tell us the lie that these things are not true. We know we are his beloved, that he's the healer of our soul and our hearts, that he helps us to become more like him. So as we end with this prayer, Lord, you are the healer of our hearts. We ask that through this prayer, all of us this week are transformed more and more into the likeness of your own sacred heart. Let your kindness, let your compassion, let your mercy transform our hearts and bring us always into the security of your loving embrace. Let us stand and profess the faith. We'll pray the Nicene Creed, which is in the front cover of the hymn book. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man.
For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. And I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. We now lift our prayers to our Heavenly Father.
For the Spirit's guidance as the Church seeks to follow Christ's humble service, and for all the baptized who continue the mission of Jesus and produce a rich harvest for God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who yearn for freedom or healing in the sacrament of reconciliation, and for all who share in the sufferings of Christ through illness and pain, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
On this Solidarity Sunday, let us extend our prayer to all humanity and entrust to God our Father the needs of our world and the aspirations of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For lands affected by political instability, violence, and natural disasters, and for the release of all hostages in Nigeria, Haiti, and Gaza, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God's name will be glorified by all the faithful who love and serve the Church, especially those called to serve as priests, we pray to the Lord. For all those who have died recently, and for the spiritual and physical well-being of all our parishioners, we pray to the Lord.
Lord God, our Heavenly Father, hear and answer all the prayers we make this morning with humble hearts. In the name of Jesus, your Son, in the power, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, you are God forever and ever.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Hear us, Almighty God, in having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just that we should give you thanks and praise, O God, Almighty Father, for all you do in this world through our Lord Jesus Christ. For though the human race is divided by dissension and discord, yet we know that by testing us, you change our hearts, and you prepare them for reconciliation. Even more, by your Spirit, you move human hearts that enemies may speak to each other again, adversaries join hands, and people seek to meet together. By the working of your power, it comes about, O Lord, that hatred is overcome by love, that revenge gives way to forgiveness, and discord is changed to mutual respect. Therefore, as we give you ceaseless thanks with the choirs of heaven, we cry out to your majesty on earth, and without end we acclaim. You, therefore, Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on the same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Celebrating, therefore, the memorial
of the death and the resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people, and may he keep us in communion with Francis, our Pope, and Ronald Peter, our Bishop, and all the bishops, and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and our sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
This upcoming Friday, the Knights of Columbus in Leamington will be preparing the last of the Lenten fish fries in the church hall at St. Michael's. This is for dine-in only, and you must call to register before Thursday at 5 p.m. Please see the bulletin for more detailed information. After the fish fry, please join us at either St. John de Brébeuf or St. Michael's Church at 7 p.m. for the Stations of the Cross. A beautiful way to prayerfully commemorate Jesus' passion and death on the cross. Everyone is invited to a paint night sponsored by St. Michael's Catholic Women's League this coming Friday, March 22nd at 7:30 p.m. Everyone will be instructed on how to paint a beautiful resurrection cross on canvas by a local artist. Cost is $35 a person and includes all supplies needed. Please see the bulletin for more information or to purchase your ticket. All-day confessions across the Diocese of London will be held on Wednesday, March 20th. For confession times and places in our family of parishes, please refer to today's bulletin.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Bow down for the blessing. Bless, O Lord, your people who long for the gift of your mercy. And grant that what at their prompting they desire, they may receive by your generous gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl throughout the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. St. John de Brébeuf. Yes.